visiting scholar here at DTHI, and I'm also a faculty associate at Johns Hopkins in the Department of International Health. My training is in cell biology. I have a PhD in cell biology. So over the last year, I've transitioned from studying humans at the level of cells to studying populations of humans. So it's been an interesting year for me. And most of this transition was triggered because of some volunteer work that I did for a local nonprofit in San Francisco, where I worked to develop a mobile phone-assisted cardiovascular teaching tool. And we implemented this project in Ghana for a really short period of time, and that got me really interested in public health and mobile health. And since graduation this summer, I've been working on a number of different projects, mostly in maternal and child health and mobile health. So today I'm going to talk about this project called MTICA, which I'm working on in collaboration with my colleagues at Johns Hopkins. TICA actually means vaccine in Bangla. I know you guys are eating Indian food, but it has nothing to do with So our project MTICA is basically a mobile phone-based vaccine registry system that we hope will improve the timeliness and coverage of vaccinations in Bangladesh. But before I really delve into how we went about designing MTICA and talk to you about why we really need a system like MTICA in Bangladesh in the first place, I want to talk a little bit about mHealth and tell you why I think mHealth is a really powerful tool, especially in resource-limited settings. So the WHO defines mHealth or mobile health as the provision of health services and information via mobile technologies such as mobile phones and PDAs. In a more practical context, people have expanded this definition to include networks and other accessory devices that connect via mobile phones, such as biosensors, GPS devices, speedometers, and such. So mobile technology is really one of the more recent technologies in what we call ICT, information communication technologies in health. And ICT really started with telemedicine, which is the use of phones for providing remote clinical services, mostly targeted towards treatment. So somebody has a condition, you know, you provide treatment advice to them over the phone. And then people realize, why just, you know, stick to treatment? We can also provide preventive messages over the phone. And that's how telehealth came along. With the advent of computers, people realized they could now store and manage health-related data really efficiently using computers. So that's how e-health came along, and we're all familiar with electronic health records that we can access here in the U.S. So mHealth came along, and really why people were very attracted to mHealth is because you can now combine the communication power that you have from a phone with the computing power that you have from a desktop into technology that fits in the palm of your hand. Imagine how powerful that can be in a developing country where you have health workers who are out in the field in remote areas. You know, how many interesting applications can you push to them? Nowadays, with the advent of biosensor technology and the ability to monitor health in real time, I think the possibilities for mHealth applications are limited. So really what makes mHealth exciting is its portability compared to the other ICT technologies. But why are we as people in public and global health really, really interested in mHealth? And I think it's because of the following reasons. I think in terms of health systems in resource-limited settings, mobile technology can help us achieve reach, scale, reduce inefficiencies in data collection, service delivery, and reporting, and facilitate health systems to achieve their goals. So what do I mean by this? So last October, we hit a population of 7 billion. The world now has 7 billion people. International Telecommunication Union reported last year that mobile phone subscriptions are now up at 6 billion. What does this mean? This means that you can access 87% of the world's population just by using mobile phones. And in a developing context, this number is about 80%, and it's growing every year. In fact, ITU also reported that people are twice as more likely to use their mobile phones to access internet as opposed to fixed broadband. So this is again exciting, and those of you who have worked in developing context know how true this is in those settings. Okay, so that was reach. So imagine a health system that wants to reach a target population. But enhanced technologies offer them that medium to reach their target population. What about scale? So scale is slightly different from reach. Now, health systems want to reach a lot of people, but they also want to provide useful services to them, right? And it's not just useful services, it's useful quality health services. And we are all aware that there is a real shortage of trained physicians in developing countries. In fact, I read a report a couple of days ago which said that in certain African countries, there is only one trained physician per 11,000 people. And that's really, really low. So what health systems are doing right now is they are focusing on task shifting. So they are hiring cadres of community health workers who now function at the edge of the network and function as liaisons between the clients and the health system. But the caveat is that these community health workers are not really trained also, right? So how do you make a health system achieve quality? So in my opinion, using mobile technologies at the edge of the network, you can actually push decision support tools to these community health workers and help them provide quality care. You can provide scheduling and reminder systems that help them remain accountable to their clients. And using a phone as a phone, right, that's the basic thing. You can use a phone as a phone and allow clients to contact these community health workers and elicit a response from the health system. Mobile technologies can also help reduce inefficiencies in data collection, healthcare delivery, and reporting. Even in the US, where we have a really established electronic health record system, what is the first thing that you do when you go to a doctor's office? You fill a paper form, right? So in a developing context, you have these health workers who are out in the field. They are carrying a load of ledgers and registers that they need to fill data into. They take this back to their clinic where the data is uploaded on the servers. And there's often a really large delay in the amount of time that goes between collecting the data, uploading the data, and analyzing the data. And mobile technologies can really reduce inefficiencies and delays in that process. So I think that reach, scale, and reduce inefficiencies can help health systems achieve their goals. In fact, I want to point out here that many countries now have a national health information technology policy in place. In fact, in India, the National Rural Health Mission in 2006 hired community health workers who provide maternal and child health services in rural areas. And it's now in the process of equipping them with smartphones. In Rwanda, I actually read that they don't even fund or allow projects that don't fit within their national health strategy. In Bangladesh, where we work, you know, the government is really keen that new mobile technology that comes into the country is compatible with their national health information system. Uganda is a really interesting case. You know, they were really open to mobile technology. And as a result, a lot of organizations and universities started piloting their interventions there. And early this year, Uganda said, stop, right? What they wanted to do was to stop all activity, go back to the drawing board, and design a national health ID policy and only allow mHealth technology that fits within their strategy henceforth. So why I'm telling you all this is because if you go out there to a developing country and want to, implement a mobile phone technology, you need to know this because you need to work within a health system in order for your technology to be accepted. So this is the framework that I've been working on with the WHO, which kind of articulates health system goals and mHealth strategies that can be used to achieve health goals. I know it's a lot of material, but let me see if you can actually see the point. Can you guys see this? Okay, so let's take the example of MCHICA, right? So this is the maternal and child health continuum, which describes the different stages that a mother goes through and then a child goes through. So for MCHICA, we are addressing needs for infants, right? And the health system function that we are focusing on is routine immunization. So what does the health system need to do to achieve routine immunization? It needs to make sure that everybody gets timely and complete vaccination, and it needs to make sure that there is continuous vaccine supply, right? So how can a mHealth system help achieve that? So So the way to do that is first to identify who are the children who need to be vaccinated, right? And that's where your registration and vital events tracking comes in. Because you can use that to enumerate clients and make sure you recognize everybody that's out in the field that needs care. Having electronic health records on the phone, health workers now know what vaccines have been provided to the kids and what vaccines are due. So there is continuity of care. Scheduling and reminder systems can be used to provide reminders to mothers and say, hey, you know, your child is due for vaccination, so bring your child to the vaccination center. And so on. So what we've tried to do in this framework with the WHO is to try to distill all possible mHealth strategies into these 10 large domains. And if you want to design an application, I would suggest, you know, especially in maternal and child health, look through this list and see how many of these strategies you can leverage. So basically what I've tried to say here is that you need to design to address a health system need, and that's really, really critical. I know Eric mentioned this a few weeks ago. You need to use an iterative participatory design process because the ultimate users are health workers who are also burdened, right? So you don't want to design something new that's going to add to their workflow and add burden to them. So you want to understand their existing workflow, identify inefficiencies in that, and design something that will address those inefficiencies. I highly recommend focusing on integrated approaches rather than a vertical solution. If you look at MTICA in the context of this framework, right, all the health system goals and all the possible strategies, MTICA occupies a really thin slice of this framework. And that's what we call a vertical solution. And that's not good. But I'm going to tell you later how we are going to convert MTICA into a larger integrated solution. So hang in there. I would also recommend focusing on interoperability, scalability, and sustainability. I see no point in designing applications that are good for one district or one hospital. I feel like even after the pilot is over, an application should be useful to the community. So that's a really big deal in the projects that I work on. And finally, use rigorous scientific methodology to evaluate impact. Now, the mHealth field so far has been driven by innovators, right? People in technology who have created smartphones, who have created amazing technology that goes with the smartphone. But the challenge is that those people are not really well-versed with population health methods. This is where you all come in. This is where we all come in. Because we have training in epidemiology, biostatistics, social science methodology. And we can adapt the methodology that we know to evaluate mHealth applications. So to work in mHealth, you don't have to be a programmer, right? You can work on the monitoring and evaluation side, which is where I work. So there's a huge need for people who are willing to do that. And I would say instead of trying to do something different, use the skills that you're already learning. So let me get to MTICA, because I know most of you are here for that. So why do we really need a system for improving timely vaccination in Bangladesh? So this is a snapshot of some statistics from Bangladesh in 2009. And if you look at the infant mortality rate, it's really high. And approximately 15% of the infants that died due to vaccine preventable diseases. So, you know, there is a real need for making sure that infants are vaccinated on time. Now, Bangladesh uses the Expanded Program on Immunization, or EPI, which was started by WHO in the 1970s. When EPI came to Bangladesh in 1979, the vaccine coverage in the region was less than 10%. So less than 10% of the infants in Bangladesh were getting vaccinated. But since then, they have expanded and they have started outreach clinics in the rural areas, due to which coverage is now way over 90%. And it's amazing what they have achieved. So what is the problem, right? What we have found is that even though the overall coverage is really high, children are not getting vaccinated on time. So what do I mean by that? So there's a concept of crude vaccination and valid vaccination, and I don't know if you've learned this somewhere, but crude vaccination is estimated by asking, did your child ever receive the DPT vaccine before she was 12 months of age, right? And If the answer is yes, you get, you know, a point for crude vaccination. But valid vaccinations is, the first dose of DPT vaccine is due between 6 and 10 weeks of age. Did your child receive the DPT vaccine between 6 and 10 weeks of age? So if your child received the DPT vaccine in that time frame, then you get a point, otherwise not. But you could still get a point for crude vaccination. So these numbers that you see, these awesome numbers, over 90%, are all crude vaccination days. They are not timely vaccination days. Now, why do you need timely vaccination at all, right? So timely vaccination windows are determined based on when the immune system of the body is ready to produce antibodies against diseases. If you provide vaccination too early, then your body is not ready to produce the antibodies. If you vaccinate too late, you have now allowed a window of time when the child is not protected, right? That's why people have come up with the concept of valid vaccination. So we were really interested in valid vaccination, and we looked at that. And we analyzed some data from a study that was going on in Bangladesh, which is the Jivita study. I don't know, some of you might have heard about it. It's a study run by Johns Hopkins, and the basic purpose of the study is to look at the effect of micronutrient supplementation on maternal and infant mortality in rural Bangladesh. So what they did was, between 2001 and 2007, they followed 60,000 mothers and over 44,000 children in the Gaibandha and Rangpur rural districts in Bangladesh. Now, as part of this study, they also collected immunization data. And that's the data I took and analyzed for my master's thesis. We fit some inclusion-exclusion criteria based on, you know, whether the infant died during the study or the mother died during the study, or if the infant was missing all immunization information. And we were left with 50% of the cohort that we started with. But we got some really interesting results. So we looked at vaccinations up to 3 months of age, right? Approximately 14 weeks. So this is the schedule of vaccines that the child is supposed to receive by 3 months. So one dose of BCG at birth, three doses of DPT, and three doses of OPV at 6, 10, and 14 weeks. Now what happens is that if you look at how many children got vaccinated on time, that number is only 20%. Right? So at 3 months, you have 20% of infants who are vaccinated on time. By 6 months, I'm not showing that data, but 60% of the infants are vaccinated. But they are not vaccinated on time. They're already vaccinated late because they were not vaccinated at 3 months. By 12 months, you get the numbers that EPI shows, which is 90%, right? So there's this real need to improve the timeliness of vaccination of these infants. Another interesting result that we found in this study was infants of mothers who sought antenatal care were more likely to be vaccinated on time compared to mothers who did not seek antenatal care. So we think that the benefits of seeking antenatal care extend beyond pregnancy to impact the infant immunization status. And I'll tell you why this is relevant in a bit. And this is not just data from our study. There have been several publications, and I'm showing you two results here. There was a study that analyzed 31 low and middle income countries and looked at the timeliness of vaccination. And they showed that only 35.5% of children in Bangladesh received age-appropriate DPT, which was due at 14 weeks, which was included in our analysis. And they showed that in the other 30 countries, timeliness of vaccination was also low. Here's another study in Uganda, which is even worse, like only 18% of children received timely vaccination. So this is not a problem, not just a problem in Bangladesh, it's a problem worldwide. So what did we find when we went and did more formative research in Bangladesh? So one was that timely vaccination rates were low. The other thing was that the existing processes during the EPI outreach clinic are time consuming. Now here is a picture of this health worker who's sitting there, and guess what she's doing? She's filling out three registers plus a vaccination card. She has this stack of vaccination cards that she still needs to fill, right? And then she's walking around hauling these registers. When she goes back to her office, she needs to sit and input all this data. And, you know, God forbid she has to look for somebody's information in there, because she just has to leaf through the ledgers to get to that information. So this is a problem. We also noticed that there was a need for immunization records that are not the sole responsibility of the mother to keep. So we found that mothers who came to the EPI outreach clinic without the immunization card that was given for their infant were sent back and asked to fetch the immunization card. We think there are better ways to do this, right? And this is an example of this is the actual immunization card that they use. You know, page one is biographical information. Page two is, you know, these are all the different vaccines. And these are the doses. Page three is what I find really interesting. It's like, it's a page that provides counseling to the mother and tells her why it's important to bring her child for vaccination. What you see in the red boxes in the center are names of diseases that vaccinations prevent. So it's like polio, diphtheria, tuberculosis, and so on. But look at what's below. Here's the translated version. Right. On completion of 6 weeks or 42 days after birth, give your child GPT, hepatitis B, or pentavalent, and the first dose of OPV. How many people understood what that meant? Okay. Within an interval of 4 weeks or 28 days, provide the second and third dose of all these vaccines. Oh my God. Okay. How are you going to do all this? So this is the information that they are providing to the mothers. This is really important information. I'm not doubting that. And this is accurate information. But this information can be really simplified when it's provided to the client. Page four is actually reporting. They take the data that's on page two and they aggregate it to provide reports. So we think we can also automate this process. They don't need to fill the numbers in twice. This is the other inefficiency that we found. So basically the way the EPI outreach camps work is that the government establishes a schedule when the health workers go to different villages. And that guy over there with the syringe, he's a health assistant. He's the guy who's responsible for giving vaccinations to infants. So what he does is that a day before the camp is supposed to be held in a village, he goes around door to door and reminds mothers that there's an EPI camp in that area, right? If I'm a mother and I'm not at home, I've missed the notification. And the only way I would know is the next day I pass this house and I see this yellow banner hanging on the balcony, right? In some cases when the camp is held in the center of the village, you can see that the yellow flag is a tablecloth. You can barely see it. And it's buried under the mound of ledgers that we talked about before. So this is again a really inefficient way of notifying people, and one of the reasons why we think people don't show up on time is because they don't know there is a camp in their area. So we were interested in building a system that was scalable, that would be applicable to all of Bangladesh. As I mentioned, Hopkins has a study in Gaibandha, which is right here in blue. What we did was we also went to another Hopkins site in Sylhet, and we looked at EPI camps there. And we made sure that the processes that were being followed by EPI in terms of notifying clients, the way they maintained the records and everything was the same. And we found that was true, which meant that a system that we designed and tested in Gaibandha would also be applicable in Sylhet. So let's get to the system itself. So these are some of the things that we found in formative research and decided to address in MCAT, and I'm just going to remind you. So first we found timely vaccination rates are low, so we thought we'd incorporate a reminder and scheduling system. We found that the burden of data collection and reporting was high, and therefore we thought we'd incorporate electronic data collection and real-time reporting. We saw that vaccination records were maintained in an inefficient manner. Those yellow cards that I showed, they are made from really thin card paper. They can tear easily, they spoil in the monsoon, which is a huge problem in Bangladesh. So it's not something that mothers can maintain. They have the responsibility for maintaining it because that's the only record they get. So we thought electronic vaccine records that can be accessed through any phone might be useful. Then I talked about how the health assistants go around notifying clients in person. But this is a job that can be easily done through SMS notifications. And finally, I showed you page 3 of the vaccination card where there's passive counseling on the importance of vaccination, and we thought active vaccine knowledge assessment counseling might be more useful. So this is what it looks like. So we have a pregnancy surveillance system through the Jivita study where we can identify women in late stage pregnancy. And and we, what we want to do is to identify these women in Part A and then provide that information to the health assistant, who was that guy in the picture holding the syringe, right? We want to give them Android-based phones, smartphones, that they can then use to register this mother, get a phone number that can be used to contact her. And then once this new pregnant woman is registered in the phone actually will prompt the health assistant to conduct an assessment of vaccination needs. So it'll spit out a statement like, your child is too young to be vaccinated. And then the health assistant can wait for the mother to respond saying yes or no, and then say, you know, actually that's true or that's not true, and so on. So I think that's a more active way of counseling and it might be more effective. The one thing that we do also during this pregnancy registration is to provide mothers a way to send a birth notification to the MTICA server, so that when a child is born, the mother can use her own phone to send an SMS message to the MTICA server with the birth date of the child. And SMS technology is like the most common denominator in most countries, so most people who have phones also have access to SMS technology. So we think that they should be able to do that if given the instructions properly. Once the birth notification is sent, the MTICA system auto-generates a vaccination schedule for the infant, such that, you know, a week before the infant is due for vaccination, the mother gets an SMS reminder saying, hey, your child is due for vaccination, and there is an ECI camp in your area. Okay? On the day of the camp, the health assistant can again use his smartphone to push a notification saying that the camp is open. This notification syncs with the server and provides message back to women whose infants are due for vaccination that day and says, hey, the ECI camp is open, and don't forget to bring your vaccination card. Right? Then if the mother brings the child to the vaccination center, the health assistant can update the vaccination record instantly using the phone. And that is available now for the mother to access. So we have built in a provision wherein mothers can send a short SMS code to the MTICA server and retrieve their child's vaccination record, so that if they're at the doctor's or something and they need to look up the vaccination record, they can. So in that sense, we are democratizing the information that's available to these clients. Finally, the information on the MTICA server will sync with the larger national health information system. I mentioned that the Bangladeshi government is really pushing for systems to be compatible with their health information system. In fact, now we are in talks with them about not even using our own server, but using their server directly. And what can be done is, through this, we can generate performance reports for supervisors to look at. So when an ECI camp is done, the supervisor can see how many kids came to the camp, how many kids were vaccinated, did we run out of vaccines, right? Which vaccines are given, and so on. So all of these reports are generated automatically and really soon, right, as opposed to paper records. And therefore, any action that needs to be taken can be taken immediately. So there are a couple other overlays to this system. One is that we recognize that not all mothers own a phone, right? So what we have done is we allow the mothers to designate a vaccine advocate. So vaccine advocate is somebody who is a friend or a relative or somebody they know and who has access to a phone and who they trust and who is willing to pass on the messages that they get on behalf of the infant to the mother, right? So in that case, you would just replace the mother with the vaccine advocate in this diagram and then have the vaccine advocate convey the messages to the mother. So that's one thing. The other thing is that till now I talked about proactive messages, so, you know, telling people come for vaccination, you're due for vaccination. But we also have reactive messages built in. So for instance, if we know that a mother is due and the mother has not provided birth notification, we can send a query to the mother and also to the health assistant and say that this mother was due, she hasn't sent in a birth notification, go follow up, see what's up. Right? Similarly for vaccination. If a child is due for vaccination and doesn't show up at the clinic, then we alert the health assistant. And the health assistant can follow up and see why the child did not get the vaccination. And the system also reschedules that child for the very next vaccination camp that is due. So the mother will again get a reminder, you know, whenever the next camp is due. So what we did was we used paper prototyping to get feedback from the health assistant. So we did all this. We did workflow mapping. We saw what the health assistants were doing. We collected, you know, scans of the ledgers and the vaccination cards, and we translated them and made sure that the data that we collect is the same as the data that they're already collecting. Right? And then we use paper prototyping. So this is what a paper prototype looks like. It's just a mock-up of a screenshot. So this is, these are the functionalities that are offered on the main menu. So you have register, clinic, scan barcode, list, report. So register is a function you use whenever there is a new client, new child, or new pregnant woman. When you press that button, you know, there's a form that opens up, and then you can type in information about the mother or the child. I think the clinic functionality is the most interesting, because the health assistants can view supplies, announce that an EPI camp is open, or look at their schedules in terms of where they are going next. So this is the announce module, where all the health assistant has to do on the day of the EPI camp is hang the flag, take out the phone, punch in the camp number and say send, and all mothers whose infants are due for vaccination are notified that the EPI camp is open. There's this other view supplies module. So this is the kind of cold box that the health assistants use to carry vaccines around. And as you can see, it's really small. They have limited storage capacity. So they need to know, you know, how many vaccines are needed for a certain outreach camp. So what we've done is we've automated that process. And based on the list of infants who are due for vaccination, we can tell the health assistants, these are the minimum number of doses that you need to provide at today's camp, right? So this is the minimum inventory you need to take enough vials, so that you can provide those many doses of vaccine. The scan barcode option is something that we are testing. Most infants and mothers can be recognized based on information that's on the vaccination card. But as I mentioned, the vaccination cards tear easily, they spoil in the monsoon. So we want to try giving them barcodes like this one that can be scanned to pull up the vaccine history, right? So this is the vaccine history of this child with this barcode. And all the health worker has to do is, if the health worker provides the pentavalent vaccines, then just press yes on the smartphone, right? And then that gets recorded. Ultimately, we want to move away from having any physical identification system. We don't want vaccine cards. We don't want barcodes. We just want a mother to be able to get to an EPI outreach clinic, say, you know, this is my name, this is my child's name, this is my husband's name. And for us to be able to use that information to identify that woman from the database and pull up the screen, right? The other thing we are doing is, you know, with this kind of technology, it's really easy to just sit at home and say, yes, given pentavalent, yes, given DBT, vaccinated all kids for this camp and next week's camp. So what we've done is we are asking the health assistant to take pictures of vials that they are using to provide vaccines. It's not foolproof, but it's something. And the advantage of doing that is that this information can in the future be used to manage supply chains. So you now know which lots of vaccines are being used up, right? And you know whether you're running out of vaccine vials and whether the health system has to order more. So this is an added functionality that we are planning in phase two. So right now we have completed the formative research phase. There's an in-country programming team which is working on actually building the Android application. We are also developing a research plan that we will use to evaluate whether MTECA actually improves the timeliness of vaccination. So we want to have a research overlay on top of the implementation which we can use to collect data and see whether, you know, the number 20% goes up at 3 months. So in phase one of MTECA, we are only looking at vaccinations up to 3 months of age. In phase two, we will expand that to include vaccines that are due up to 5 years of age. Maternal TB vaccine is not covered under phase one, but as I showed from the data from the UNICEF study, that mothers who sought antenatal care had infants who were vaccinated on time with a higher probability. So we're going to include maternal TB vaccine as well in phase two, so that pregnant women can be notified that they need to go seek antenatal care and get TB vaccine. Supply chain management is again something that we can incorporate in phase two. In terms of client enrollment, right now we are focusing on women in late pregnancy because we want to identify newborns when they are born, right? the BCG dose is due at birth. So we want to know when somebody is born as soon as they're born. But in later, in phase two, we will start recruiting women in early pregnancy as well because we want to provide them the maternal TT vaccine reminders. And we'll also include children up to 5 years of age. So we will allow children to come in later in the sequence of vaccine. Right now, the study is located in Kalbala, the Sylhet district where Hopkins has a presence. But we plan to include additional studies, additional districts in the scale. As I mentioned earlier, we have government buy-in for this program. And this is actually the Android tablets that the government is going to give all their health workers. So what we're going to do is once we have the programming code and we have evaluated our application, we're going to share the programming code with the government. And we've already made sure that the data that we collect is compatible with the national health management information. Now remember I mentioned that MCCA was a really thin vertical slice, and that's a no-no. So what I didn't tell you was the Jivita people have other applications that they are designing and implementing. There's an M registry system which focuses on the pregnancy surveillance part that MCCA is not doing, right? So it focuses on identifying pregnant women on time, registering births, and so on. There's also an M care system which focuses on providing antenatal care and providing support during obstetric emergencies and so on. So all of these systems are going to be compatible with the Android tablet that the government is going to give to the health workers. So when we share the programming code with them, the government can just incorporate all of these applications into one large application that would cover everybody from pregnancy to childhood. Right, in this so that's the plan, and that's where I'm going to stop. I just want to acknowledge the MCCA team. Alan Labrique is a professor, is an assistant professor in epidemiology and international health at Johns Hopkins, and he's the PR of the project. So Cheta Mehra, Subhash, Neil Singh, and Kelsey are all involved with this project. Actually, Kelsey is our student intern who's in Bangladesh right now and who did all the wonderful formative research work that we saw today. The Empower team, so this is our in-country partner who's doing the programming. Dr. A.K. Azad is the director of the Health Information Management System in Bangladesh, and he's the Directorate General of Health Services for the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And we've been really fortunate in having his support for this project, and he has provided us with some really valuable advice that we've incorporated into this application. So phase one of this project is funded through the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation Grand Challenge of Exploration. Once we finish phase one, we'll seek funding for phase two and then add all the additional functionalities that I showed before. So I'll stop now and I'll be happy to answer any questions. And thanks again for coming.
Within MCCA, who owns your data? Because normally in a normal situation, I would think that the investigator team controls their own data, but in a situation like this where you're sharing the technology of the system and matching it to their own databases, does it become a country-owned thing, or is it a
national?
And does the WHO provide any sort of guidance in regards to mobile technology and digital access to who owns data like that?
I'm not sure about the licensing and who owns the data part, but what I'm working on with the WHO right now is they are setting up an mHealth technical advisory group, and the whole purpose of this group is to unify taxonomies in mHealth and reproductive maternal and child health, and see how you can leverage existing methodology from epidemiology and such and use it to evaluate mHealth applications, right? So in terms of that and in terms of providing guidance on how to scale up your application, how to make sure you can talk to your stakeholders and things like that, WHO is setting up a whole committee to advise projects. So they will be putting out technical guidance on those topics of research.
So for like troubleshooting with applications, would be hired to help us, or are you using people from like WHO or people from the Bangladesh community?
So Empower? Empower is our in-country team.
Okay.
They are in Bangladesh, and they are the ones who are programming this.
And then they're working on behalf of the government, or on behalf
they will provide government the support they need, depending on what the government decides.
Okay, so it's no specific NGO or anything?
No.
So modern technology like computers and cell phones are obviously really helpful for projects like this, but it's also not always completely reliable. Like even here we have technology problems all the time. So if there's really important information like vaccine records being kept on these phones, and let's say like the whole program shuts down, mm-hmm. are there like backup plans that you guys have strategized for in case something like that happens?
So the vaccine records are not stored on the phone, they're on the server. So hopefully, like the government has backup systems, like if one server is lost, they have other servers that the data is duplicated on. Right. But in terms of, you know, if I'm trying to fill out a form and I lose connectivity, we have some contingency approaches in the design where you can queue the data on the phone, so that when connectivity returns, the data can be sent. Right. But sometimes you just lose data, and that's part of it. Right. You're filling a form and then the phone dies or something doesn't save. Those kinds of things happen even with our computers. And it's frustrating, but that's part of using technology. The same can happen with paper records. You know, I can have a stack of papers and they can fall into a river or a lake, or you know, monsoon can come around and bugs can eat the paper. What do you think? Yeah.
I was wondering how strong like their power grid is in Bangladesh. Like, do the rural areas always have power consistent enough power to power their phones?
I mean, it's not that reliable. So we have to make sure that when there is power, we charge our phones in terms of providing that service. But it's improving. When the Geneva study started in 2001, there were no cell phone towers in Bangladesh. Now I've heard that there are like 4 towers. Like right on the highway, and you know, people have network connectivity. So the infrastructure is improving every day. So,
okay.
Yeah. I'll go there for you.
Mm-hmm. How would you suggest evaluating Antigua as you're scaling it up through phase one and into phase two?
So what we're thinking of right now is having 2, not districts, but areas. One where the health assistant would use Antigua, and one where they won't. Right, they will continue to follow existing standard of care. And then we would collect data in the same way in the 2 regions and then compare. So that's sort of the design that we're going.
Thank you.
Go to Frank.
One of the problems in Cambodia is getting the vaccine to the camps alive.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Have you thought about tracking the temperature as it makes its path along the chain, or assessing the viability of the vaccine when it's at the camp?
So we don't have that in our system. There are other mobile applications which are sort of wanting to do that, but I don't know if there is a real application which does this at the moment. Right. But that is a need. Yeah.
It's really exciting work. Thank you for presenting it today. You're doing a lot of work and using a lot of technology to get these kids with their mom at a specific place and time. And it seems like, have you planned other sort of healthcare services that you provided at those homes besides vaccination?
During the EPI camp?
Yeah.
No, the EPI camps are really specific.
Okay.
The overall aim of this is, you know, once the health workers start using these tablets, right, that's when you have multiple applications that are in an integrated fashion, right? You have MCARE, which provides antenatal care. But there's also different levels of health workers who provide those functions. So health assistants are primarily for vaccination, and then you have family welfare assistants, like the ladies who are sitting in the patient notes. You know, they are the ones who liaison more for the antenatal care and so on. So there's a lot of complexity in how the health system is organized, so you have to take that into consideration. And these camps are a separate activity. They don't provide other services during that time. Although, you know, as you say, if we are making the effort to get them to the camp, we might as well provide other services. I mean, we can at least try education and counseling and, you know, motivating them to go seek other services. So that's a good point.
I did some work in Western Kenya on immunizations, and one of the problems there, like a barrier to a program like this, was that people switch phone numbers really frequently. Like, right about more minutes with their phone, they just buy a new SIM card. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering if that's an issue in this context, or how do you deal with it?
That's something we are concerned about, and we're going to see in our phase one how often that happens in Bangladesh and whether it's a barrier, you know. If we tell people that we need to know when you switch your phone number, do they actually tell us? Right? That's something we want to look at. And based on what we learn in phase one, we implement something in phase two. So that's a real issue.
One of the things you could do is embed your apps on the SIM card so that the app goes with the SIM card, and that way if they put in a new SIM card and it doesn't have the app on, they're out of business.
Right, so on the client side, there is no app. They're just using their phone. They're just using SMS technology on the phone. The app is on the health worker side. And the health worker is actually going to get the tablet, so they're not going to switch. It's on the client side that we have issues where, you know, client can change his or her phone or, you know, get a new SIM card. So it's a slightly more tricky problem, because they're using their existing technology. We are not giving them phones. We're not providing any equipment to them. So it's something that we cannot do at this point. But I guess it's an excellent solution for other systems where they provide phones to clients.
So it seems very like mother to child. Are you also like give out the phone number? You also like get the phone numbers of like fathers as well, so that even if they get the notification, they can let their wives know, some of the family know that, oh, my child is also due for an appointment. Like, is the whole family informed, or are you going to incorporate that?
So right now we only have the ability to collect one phone number, or we have decided to stick to one phone number. So if the mother has a phone, if she physically owns a phone and she uses it, then we want the mother to be the one who gets the notification, right? But if not, she can designate somebody. So if she decides that it's her husband that she wants, because her husband is the one who carries the phone around anyway, then that's her choice.
So I noticed your arm is DHICT for strategy, so strategy is pretty comprehensive, and it doesn't seem like it's necessarily limited to MSDH applications.
It's not.
And I'm wondering how you synthesized it, like where were those strategies drawn from, and have you thought about what is missing or could be added in a different health context for a different population? I was just curious how you thought those frameworks might be different.
So a lot of the information in this framework came from a number of documents that are provided by WHO, for example. This health system strategies and health system functions part came from the essential interventions document that the WHO has put out. This continuum came from another WHO document. As far as the mHealth and ICT strategies go, there are a number of frameworks out there, and we tried to put together as much information as we could from those frameworks. What we also did is that WHO has a set of 8 projects that they are guiding and helping scale up. Mm-hmm. So we took those projects and applied them to this framework and saw whether they fit in or not. And then based on that, we tweaked the framework to ensure that, you know, everything included. Mm-hmm. And we are continuing to revise this diagram. It's only a draft version. And you can imagine that there could be multiple layers to this framework. So this defines the mHealth strategy with respect to health system goals. But you could also have something that talks about technology, right? Mm-hmm. Whether you're using SMS or IVR or, you know, what kind of technology, what kind of phone. You can have another layer on top of this that talks about evaluation, right? Are you using an RCT or, you know, other kinds of methodology? Are you looking at qualitative indicators, quantitative indicators, mm-hmm. right? And there's also one layer where you can look at the where on the life cycle of development is the application? Is that formative research, pilot phase, programming, you know? So there's a whole bunch of layers that can be created underneath this one, and that's something that we are working on. But basically what we did with this one was use existing literature to synthesize as much information as we could, try to fit in projects and try to refine this, and we're continuing to do that.
Literacy in Bangladesh hovers around 50%. How does that work with SMS messaging?
So basically, we want to make sure that mothers who own phones can read the SMS messages and are able to send SMS messages. If not, we're going to ask them to designate somebody who can. Right. that's why we have this whole concept of vaccine advocates. I don't think any application has really tested this concept of having vaccine advocates. So that's something novel that we are testing out here, and we want to see how it works. So that's a concern, that we want to make sure that the application is used by somebody who can be. And it is in the local language, though. Even for the health assistant, the program is in Bangla, it's not in English. Which is why we have the in-country team doing the programming, and it's not us, because we cannot program in Bangla.
Going off of that, would it be too hard to have a phone call, like automatically have a phone call be sent, so they pick it up and hear, like, your child is due, or
there's mixed feelings about that in the literature. Some people think that that's a great way to address the literacy barrier, but other people feel that it's too intrusive. For a lot of the applications, mothers feel that they want to get SMS messages and not IVR. And that's something also we can evaluate during phase one, because we are planning to ask the mothers whether they liked receiving the SMS messages, whether they understood them, and whether they would like to receive more or less of these, those kinds of qualitative questions. And we can ask them if, we want voice messages instead of SMS messages. So that's why we have phase one, because whatever we learn from phase one, we can tweak in phase two.
Are there any ways in which you wish you would have improved the research?
I'm sorry,
are there any things about the research that you wish you could have improved?
The formative research?
Yeah.
So a lot of the findings that we have are more sort of observational and qualitative. We got funding for this project in May. Okay, so we've been working on this project for a really short time. And so we haven't had the chance to get IRB approval to actually talk to the mothers. So that's something that's pending, and that's something that I would really like to do before we actually implement the final application. So we have tried to talk to health assistants because they are part of the research agreement that we have. And we've tried to design things from their perspective, but in terms of the SMS messages that we're gonna give to the mothers, that's something we might wanna refine more. And that's where questions about whether you want a phone message or an SMS message can be asked.
Since your data is eventually going to be owned by the government, I know it's super, super early, but at this stage, are you putting any thought or consideration into privacy or how this data might be misused? So normally, I wouldn't ask that question. If it was a private organization or a hospital doing the thing, I wouldn't have so much concern about what happens to these massive digital records.
Right. I mean, that's something that's covered by the government, health IT strategy and policy and the way that they decide to protect their servers, right?
Well, I didn't mean from outside sources, but within the government itself. I mean, in the U.S., there is a lot of resistance for that sort of national database of, say, HIV status. And I know that's not exactly what you're dealing with, but since you're in the ground floor of designing something that's going to go straight into the government, are you thinking about those sorts of things at this point, or just...
It's not a huge concern at this point, because we are working within the framework of the government,
right,
and the health system and the policies and the standards that they have. Mm-hmm. And I would say that those are pretty strict, and that's what they have decided for their country, and that's what we are following. In terms of communication between the phone and the server, we'll obviously make sure that's encrypted.
Yeah.
And that's also one reason why we wanted to use the barcode,
mm-hmm.
right? Because we don't want people to be just able to type in, like, if I know somebody and I know her name, her husband's name, her child's name, I can easily input that information and get the records. So we want to sort of make it slightly more difficult for people to access records, which is why we are trying this barcode system right now and see whether it's any better than the vaccine card. I have mixed feelings about it, but Bangladesh also has a unique ID system, as in they provide unique IDs like our SSN to people, but right now we don't know how well people remember those numbers, so that's a barrier, and that's again something we are going to test in phase one. So those are some concerns that we have, but on the bigger national scale, we are working within their framework and the standards that they have set. So, thank you all. Thank you for coming. And thank you for coming.